You know what they say, a kilobyte of prevention is worth a gigabyte of cure, or something like that. But when it comes to malware, it is absolutely true, and just knowing a few things to look out for really can make a massive difference in what risk you're at when you download a file, for example. Unfortunately, because malware can be distributed so many different ways, it's not like there's one magical trick that will save you from getting hacked ever again. But I do have one main tip and some others I'll go over just as extra that will really protect you against a vast majority of the most popular file format that viruses use, which are still EXEs. Now, I think it's always important to know what you're up against, and I found some statistics from a company, Checkpoint Research. They do analysis of virus statistics every year, and their most recent one found that recently, a lot of malware, 92% in fact, is delivered via email, and only 8% of it is delivered via the web, like downloading. And the type of files that are used in malware for emails versus web are also very different. For example, in recent times for email, most of the time it's going to be archive files and stuff like that that is going to encapsulate the malware so that it can get past email filters and stuff, and then hope that the person unpacks it and runs it locally. Whereas on the web, usually it's just a direct download. Anyway, in terms of web malware, you can see that EXEs are by far the most popular still at 49% of malware. Then surprisingly, next is .sh. So these are script files, usually for Linux and macOS. So if you're on Windows, you probably don't really need to worry about these being targeted for you, but that is interesting. Then we have PDF files and other stuff like DLLs and then doc and even PowerShell scripts. But again, the big one is EXE. But later, I will have a couple bonus tips on how to easily defend against PDF and PowerShell script attacks. Now, before getting into those tips, I have another great way to help avoid malware. Today's sponsor, Guardio. You've heard me talk about him before. It's a browser extension that provides real-time protection from all sorts of threats while browsing the web, and they just added two new major features. You may already know about their mobile app, which now adds browser protection too, so you're protected from malicious links and websites on mobile as well as desktop. And it also still alerts you about leaks of your info on the dark web, and you can scan this QR code to check all that out. Guardio also just released an exclusive new feature called Account Protection, which can shield you from attacks known as session hijacking, where hackers and malware steal your browser's session tokens and can then access your accounts bypassing all passwords and 2FA. Currently, the feature supports Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, and Twitter, with more coming soon. And it works by securing the access tokens stored by your browser. And of course, you still have all the other features, for example, download protection to block malicious files, even if you accidentally click to download them, like from fake sites for popular software, or even malicious game mods. You can scan your browser for threats for free by visiting guard.io/TheoJoe and installing the extension, and also check out the mobile app. You'll get a 7-day free trial to the premium features such as real-time threat removal, plus 20% off every month for a year. So if you want a clean and secure browsing experience, again, visit guard.io/TheoJoe, link in the description, and check out their affordable premium plan, which includes full protection for up to 5 users. And with all that being said, let's continue. Now, I don't want to keep you waiting any longer, so what is this big, giant, magical tip? Well, I said it's already not magical, it's actually quite simple, and that is to check whether or not the executable is signed with the digital signature from a trusted source. And on Windows, this is actually really simple. You simply right-click the file, go to Properties, then the Digital Signatures tab, click on the top one, there might be two, just click on the top one or each one, click Details, and then look to see if it says the digital signature is okay. And if it does, that means that the root certificate that this file was signed by is in the trusted store in Windows. And if it doesn't say that the signature is okay, it might have a red X or something, then that is definitely a red flag. Now, a couple important caveats to know. First of all, to recognize that it is an EXE file in the first place, like always, I say, you want to enable file extensions. This way, you always know what kind of file type you're dealing with. And also, you need to know this because while EXE files and other files like DLLs and even PowerShell scripts can be signed, not all files can be signed with a digital signature. So if you go looking, for example, to see if a batch file is signed, well, they can't be signed. So that's not even a thing. The other important thing to understand is you kind of have to use some critical thinking because not every single .exe file might be signed at all. A lot of open source or independent projects often don't have a digital signature, because to get a one that goes trusted all the way back to a root certificate, you usually have to get something called EV, extended verification certificate, which are extremely expensive, usually minimum $300 a year, but can go up to $500 depending what company you use. And most independent developers don't want to spend that kind of money. So with that, you might be wondering, all right, well then what good is this tip anyway? And I say it is still a very important marker you can use, and that is because malware is almost never signed with a trusted certificate. Sometimes, in very rare occasions, they are, but they usually get caught and then that signature is invalidated and then Windows won't trust it anymore. But by far, most of the time, if it's signed, it's probably fine. Now, again, if the file is not signed, does that mean it's a virus? No, but does it mean you should spend a little bit more time investigating some other stuff about the file for whether or not to trust it? Yes, absolutely. And that's going to be the other usual stuff, like what website you downloaded it from, how familiar are you with that website? Do you think it should be signed, whether or not it's from like a big company? If you go and download a file that's supposedly from Microsoft or Nvidia and you see that it's not signed, that's very weird, because they definitely have EV certificates they could sign it with. Whereas if you're just downloading something off an independent GitHub project, then it's not probably surprising that it's not signed. So it gives you additional information about whether or not to decide to trust it or not. Now, I will give one caveat, which is that if you look to see and there is a digital signature, but it does not say it's trusted or that it's okay, that can be a major red flag. It's possible that the developer did self-sign the thing, so it doesn't go back to a trusted certificate. But if you see that the signature claims to be like Microsoft or some other company that's well known, and then it says it's invalid, that means that it's basically impersonating that company. So in that case, if there is a signature that's not valid, I would probably just defer to not trusting it, or maybe look on the website to check to see if it's self-signed, that kind of thing. So in summary, if you download an .exe file and it's signed and it says okay, it's probably trustworthy in all likelihood. If it's not signed, then you probably know yourself whether or not you have the knowledge for whether or not to trust it based on where you got it, that sort of thing. But if you want to be 100% safe, then you would not run any kind of file that's not signed, just with the understanding that you're gonna be kind of throwing out the baby with the bathwater in a lot of situations, but that would be the trade-off. So now, why don't we move on to PDFs? And this one also is pretty easy to mitigate, because usually if a hacker is trying to infect something with a PDF, they're going to be using JavaScript that can be embedded into PDFs, and protecting yourself against those is just a matter of blocking the JavaScript. And if you know how to do that, which I'm going to explain in a second, you're usually safe. If you're using Adobe Acrobat or Adobe Reader, then what you need to do is go into the preferences and then security enhanced, and then look for where it says protected view and set this to all files. I don't know why in the world this is set to off by default in my experience, but you want to set it to all, and now when you open up a PDF, it should be in like the protected mode, and with that you don't have to be worried about it. Though I will point out that for some reason when it's in protected mode, it seems like it's really laggy to scroll through, so just be aware of that. Now, when it comes to PowerShell scripts and PowerShell commands, these seem to be getting more popular. And when they're just run with a command, they are actually called fileless malware, and that is a thing. And for that, you would just want to go and watch my other video where I talked about this. I talked about three steps that you can change to really lock down and secure PowerShell on your system to protect you against a lot of those types of attacks. So I'll just link that instead of talking all about it again. So definitely that is one to check out. So if you were hoping for some kind of groundbreaking new revelation on how to not get hacked, sorry to disappoint you. Usually the best security practices are very simple and straightforward. But if you were unaware about digital signatures, at least now you have another tool in your arsenal for protecting against malware. Thanks again to Guardio for sponsoring this video. Be sure to visit guard.io/theogeo to install the extension and scan your browser for threats for free. The link is also in the description. And check out the mobile app by scanning the QR code. If you want to keep watching, the next video I'd recommend is that other one where I talked about three steps to secure PowerShell on your system. I'll put that link right there. So thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.